10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome.
No. Or do not. There is no try.
You called down the thunder, well, now you've got it.
I'm coming to get you. It's time.
Jehovah's Witness, he's an ex-witness. He's been a Christian for 5 years. He was a Jehovah's Witness for 45 years. Jake, first time talking with you. Welcome here.
That is very kind. Thanks for having me on.
Awesome. You got an awesome accent. Where are you from?
From the United Kingdom.
United Kingdom. Awesome. Awesome. Well, glad to have you up here. So I don't know how long you want to talk, but glad to have you here. You talked a little bit ago about asking the right questions. And now that you are, you know, you've been a Christian now for about 5 years or so. What, maybe go back just a little bit. What helped you come out? Because 45 years is a long time.
Sure. So I was raised a Jehovah's Witness. I was born into it. My family was all Jehovah's Witnesses. And people don't realize that Jehovah's Witnesses, they're a little bit culty, really. What I mean by that, they don't really read any other materials to do with theology or scripture except for their own publications. And most of those publications, you realize afterwards, are very dubious. You know, it's harsh to say they're outright lies, but they're certainly very misleading and full of trickery. So when you're actually in it and all your friends are in it and you're discouraged from having any other association or meaningful discussion with people who aren't Jehovah's Witnesses, it's really hard to understand the flaws in one's own reasoning. So for myself, about 2018, I started to realize quite randomly that things that are taught by the witnesses were wrong. I was just on Wikipedia researching some things. And the key with Jehovah's Witnesses is don't try and think that you need to fix all of their flawed reasonings. As soon as I had one pebble in my shoe, something that was sticking with me, rubbing me, and that allowed me to do some research. And then the dominoes fall one after the other. So if you can just land one interesting thought-provoking point with a Jehovah's Witness that you speak to, that motivates them to go away and do some research in their own time. I mean, that can be the first domino. And once those dominoes fall, they just keep cascading, because a lot of what we're taught is just so ropey, effectively.
Oh, that's good stuff, Jake. Good stuff sharing that. And, you know, it's interesting because, you know, I mean, 45 years, you might have me beat on this because I've only been an apologist for 30 years, but I've got quite a bit of literature, you know, myself, of, you know, books, magazines, older books. I mean, I got the 1950 New World Translation. I've got old, you know, studies on scriptures. I've got Vindication and Creation and all the other ones, some of the old stuff from, you know, back in the day with Russell and all that. And one of the things that I've learned over the years too is a lot of times when stuff cited in these books or magazines from, like, say, a source of, say, a church father or such and such scholar, a lot of times, well, they never give you the quote reference in their books or magazines, do they?
True.
And then when you finally look it up, it doesn't say what they claim it to say. But what you just said is interesting, Jake, because a lot of times what happens is witnesses will see it, but they don't ever question it. And that's so right. They look at it and just assume it's fact. It's right. Why would the Watchtower deceive me, right? And so maybe touch on that for a second, because a lot of witnesses that I've talked to over the years, that's the hardest part, is to get them to think, could I be being misled?
You're absolutely right. That's definitely the hardest thing. And the reason for that is we're taught the governing body. So these Americans who are in a special facility called the Bethel, the worldwide headquarters of Jehovah's Witnesses there in upstate New York, America, we're trained. It's repeated all the time how they're selected by God. and everything they say is right. So there's a standard joke. We, as ex-Jehovah's Witnesses, often call it the sort of octopope, because there was eight of them, and we regard them very much like popes. Everything they say should be absolutely followed. So the best you get when you show a Jehovah's Witness something which is wrong is, in their mind, it's completely impossible for the governing body to be wrong. So all they do is they think to themselves, well, I failed in explaining that correctly to that person. So they go away often slightly crushed, because they won't even consider the possibility that their publications are wrong. They'll just regard themselves as being failures and being able to explain it, which is why you'll rarely win a debate and make a meaningful impact in the moment of the debate. But I can tell you, as soon as the first domino fell for me, all of the conversations that I'd had with sincere Christians over decades sprung back to mind, and it all helped in the cascade of it all. But definitely, as a steer, I would say, just, you know, try and land a point that'll just stay with them and leave them relatively comfortable and happy, so they're happy to mull it over. And then once they do their own research, they'll find all sorts of lies amongst their own teaching. But they've got to be motivated to want to do the follow-on research.
I think that's an excellent, excellent point, and good answer response. Let me add an additional nugget to what you said and see if you're right, or if I'm right in what you just said. So a lot of times what I've, and I've done this in the past, so I believe I've learned from this. I don't do this anymore. But a lot of times what Christians will do is they'll got like multiple topics, and they'll go to, Jehovah's Witnesses, their street carts, or go somewhere and find them, and they'll bring up all multiple topics. And so they're kind of all over the place, and they kind of get in this debate mode, and the Jehovah's Witnesses normally know how to respond to most of the things because they've been trained a certain way. And most Christians don't know how to, actually have a normal conversation. I hate saying it like that. But if I heard you correctly, when talking with a witness, if you at least have the time, try to focus on a topic and plant something of a good seed from that topic that will stick and get them to think. Did I hear that right?
Yeah, absolutely. We're trained as Jehovah's Witnesses to bounce around. So if we think we're losing on one topic, you just watch us bounce on to a different topic.
I've been there.
It's like tracking a ball in a pinball table as it just spins around.
It's like trying to nail Jello to the wall. It's like, come on, man, stick.
So I speak to, in areas where the witnesses don't know me, I've tried lots of different techniques. I'll be honest, my favorite technique is to go up to them with a big smile and say how lovely it is to see them, out in the community, really appreciate their hard work and how sincere they are. You don't see many Christian groups doing what they're doing. So I heap on praise.
And that's a true statement too. That is a true statement. Other than them being Christian, of course, yes.
Yes. But I heap on praise, set them at ease, give my name, swap names with them. And then I explain typically, I'm a Christian. And what would be the advantage for me as a Christian to becoming a Jehovah's Witness? And then they will struggle. And it's such an easy conversation because they will say things like, well, we don't believe in, and they'll choose
Trinity, totally, yes.
And you can just, not necessarily deep dive in all those things. I typically say, and there are many Christians that don't believe, in that type of hell. There are different views on hell. What else would be a good reason? And just work through it with them. And what you'll get just by asking the questions is that they are not able to differentiate any advantage of being a Jehovah's Witness. And then that leaves them wanting to go away at the end of that to really research some of those points. So sometimes just a simple conversation like that, asking questions, getting them to propose it and just gently dealing with what they suggest rather than any sort of doctrinal matters, can be just an easy, upbuilding, constructive conversation.
Now, let me ask you the question now.
Okay.
What's the advantage of now being a Christian compared to once being a Jehovah's Witness?
Yeah, well, let me just pick out a few of the key ones. So when you see those Jehovah's Witnesses, they might be calling on your door, or they might be standing by a cart in a public place. What people don't realize is that in their pocket, they've got a stopwatch going.
Yes.
So my salvation was linked to how many hours I would do in a month talking to people. And all Jehovah's Witnesses have to do a report card, and I kid you not, a report card.
Oh, I know
card.
It.
Every
I
month.
Actually have the magazine sources. I know where they're at. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And on it, how many conversations I've had with people, how many magazines I've left with people, how many times I've called back on people, how many hours. There's all sorts of statistics one has to record in there. And whether you're young or old, everyone has to put in their time card. And if the time card's not rich enough in terms of what you've done, then you can lose privileges in the congregation. You get counseled by the elders. So just the pressure on a works-based salvation.
Pressure just to be out there counting the clock.
Count the clock, which is why you'll see them often just standing in quiet areas.
Oh, that's actually an interesting point real quick. I don't want to lose your thought, but I'll sometimes see people, and they're just standing there in places where there's going to be hardly anybody walking around, and they're there for hours. And I'm going...
That's it.
They're just counting their time. That's all they're doing is counting their time.
Yeah. So
I miss it when they used to knock on the doors. I hate saying it like that, but I miss the door knockers. Like, I want a door knock. Please give me a door knock.
Yeah, because then at least you can invite them in.
Yes.
And then once they're in, you can really work with them.
Yes. So that was that. So what about now also being a Christian? Because before, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but like you said, you're counting the clock. Privileges, but then also the hope, or let me put it better, that you're not sure if you're going to make it into the new earth, right? The great crowd.
Yeah.
But now as a Christian, you do know this.
That's right. So, and I feel a bit of a silly one saying this. So in 2018, you know, I worked my way through a number of books, and then I came across C.S. Lewis and Mere Christianity. And when I read about grace and I read about the Christian salvation hope, even though I'm a grown man, I cried my eyes out. Because as Jehovah's Witnesses, you will never, ever hear the word grace.
Yes.
You are just totally told that you've just got to work as hard as you can, and then hopefully you'll be good enough to gain salvation. And when I learned about grace, It was just a transformative moment for me. I think grace, we kind of take it for granted as Christians. The fact that we have that relationship, we are saved, and then we have the opportunity through, because we're motivated, because we love Christ and we love our fellow man, we want to do good things for other people and help them. Whereas all my life, it was the other way around. I was motivated because I had to do it. So I don't really know what works I ever did because I was really motivated to do it out of love versus what I felt I had to do.
Out of fear.
Yeah.
I remember I've talked to quite a few ex-witnesses. In fact, I was at an ex-Jehovah's Witness conference last year as one of the speakers out in Sacramento, California. And then next year, I'm going to be a speaker at the same kind of one out in San Diego, California. And because they have normally a mixture of ex-witnesses and also people like myself who like to reach witnesses. And I've talked to a lot of witnesses over the years, probably maybe a little bit more than you because you've only been a Christian for a few years, but I'm sure you'll get your hands here and there. One of the things that I've heard a lot from ex-witnesses that they weren't told is that Jesus loved them.
True.
Can you recall that when you were a witness back in the day?
The thing is about Jesus, he doesn't have really a prominent role within JW theology. And I know that sounds such a bizarre thing to say, but you might go weeks at a Jehovah's Witness meeting before they even mention Jesus. It just doesn't come up that much. Mm-hmm. So they'll mention Jehovah almost hysterically, 100 times in a
like
meeting.
Chant.
Yeah, absolutely. But Jesus, he's mentioned at the end of prayers, in Jesus' name.
but it's very far and few between.
So hearing that Jesus loves you is probably a very unusual thing.
Ah, yeah, it's just not a JW concept, really. And the whole idea of being born again. So just to illustrate that, I had an estranged relationship with my father for decades. For 2018, when I became a Christian, all of the angst which I felt, or any bitterness that I had towards him as a Jehovah's Witness for decades, it all just melted away. And I really felt the experience of resentment and bitterness just absolutely disappear from me when I became a Christian. So that's very much my personal experience when you talk about that love and the transformative effect it has. You've got to remember, Jehovah's Witnesses, that they're not really born again. No. They don't consider themselves as part of God's family.
No.
It's a very different type of relationship.
Yeah. And which is even probably, you probably know this now too, Jake. It's ironic is because Romans 8 verses 9 through 11 talks about that if you don't have the Spirit of God dwelling in you, you're not one of God's.
Yeah. You're either in the flesh or you're in the Spirit.
So even in the New World Translation, it even uses the word dwell. So if the Spirit of God does not dwell within you, you are not of His. So what you just said is interesting because that's what it means to be born again. So if you don't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, you're not one of His. And the Watchtower teaches that you can't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you. Kind of ironic how that works both ways, huh?
So true.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because as a Jehovah's Witness, those words would have meant very little to me. But now they kind of mean everything to me, having experienced the before and the after. So I give quite a bit of time just helping other XJWs. There's a big community.
Yes, yes.
So the way it typically works, there's quite a few YouTube channels.
Yes.
Either by XJWs or sincere Christians like yourself with a heart for helping us crazy JWs.
I get quite a few emails from people who are exes that just, I don't even know, just like yourself, when you said earlier, I don't know you. They will send me an email from time to time saying, Kelly, thank you for what you do because I didn't know what you're sharing.
Yeah, quite right too. And then there's often weekly Zoom calls where XJWs, so you've got to remember, it's terrifying for a Jehovah's Witness to go to a church. So it's almost impossible to take a Jehovah's Witness
physically. Yeah.
Into a church. I'll be honest with you.
Yeah.
I kind of peed myself a little the first time I went into a church. That's how terrifying it absolutely is. Because we're taught they're all part of Satan's Babylon the Great.
Yes.
So
Christian. Yes.
Spot on.
Yeah.
So what's with these XJW groups?
You are so right.
Yeah.
You know, I'm talking. Yeah. I think it's easier. That's why, like, so that's kind of what's interesting. And, like, I don't know if you've seen the different discussions I've had about maybe 8-9 videos, but 5 different Jehovah's Witnesses who are inactive who have come on my channel. But like you said, they'll talk more like, you know, Zoom or this or that, but to actually go into an actual physical place, it's difficult, right? It's difficult. And so it's because of, you know, how that person was, you know, especially for someone like yourself, 45 years. I have friends that have been it for 60, 65 years that are a little bit older and come out. And, you know, it took a while for them to kind of adjust, to learn that this isn't so bad after all. I mean, people are praising Jesus. What are these people thinking, right? Like, what's, you know, and it's a different, you know, it's a different thing. And so I want to say something that's also important, what you said earlier, that I hope people don't lose. And April's in the house. April's an ex-witness. How you doing, April? Lord bless you, sister. A lot of people don't realize what you said also, too, and I don't want to lose it. When you talked about when you walk up to witnesses and you actually, you know, what's the word? Compliment them. Witnesses are not used to that.
It's true.
Right? You know, and it's a true statement. Like, I have so much respect for You know, it's going to sound weird. I'm going to sound weird. I have respect for Mormons and Muslims and Jehovah's Witnesses and other groups out there, that at least the ones that somewhat, you know, not maybe not the Muslims who are out there killing people. So let me be careful on what I word there. But because they devote so much more of their time, their money, their energy, and it can also be out of fear too. So don't get me wrong. So I don't want to say it the wrong way too, but most Christians, like you said earlier, take for granted grace. There's so much liberty that Christians have taken for granted that I'm going to sound legalistic for a second, and I fully believe in grace, but we've got to get off our butts and start getting out there and being active and doing what the cults do for a lie every day, but we do it for the truth. That's what Walter Martin used to say. I don't know much of you know about him, but I learned that many years ago. He was a former apologist. He went to be the Lord some years ago, and he was a big time guy reaching people in different beliefs. And he had a view like, look, we're Christians, and these guys are doing it way better than we are. We've got to get out there and do it for the truth, because these guys are doing it for a lie, and they're going to hell. They're going to lost without Jesus. And so what you said earlier, I think, is really good to, you know, compliment them, let them know that, you know what, you care about them. You don't just come at them screaming. Obviously, you and Ex-Witness wouldn't do that. But you, what you said, I think, was a very good thing, Jake. I just wanted to compliment you on that as well.
Thanks, Kelly. And I think one extra thing that Christians have is the Holy Spirit. And Christians sometimes are fearful of saying the wrong thing, but let the Holy Spirit do the heavy lifting. Just create the opportunity. Just enjoy a nice conversation and see where the Spirit takes that conversation, and see how the Spirit opens the heart of that JW. Create the opportunity for the Spirit to do its thing. And don't think that you need to understand witnesses. Just think of them as a person. Just enjoy a conversation with them.
Think of them as a person. What a concept. Yes. Learn to have a conversation, Jake. I don't think you could have said it any better there, man. That's great. Thank you, Jake, for coming on. I could listen to you for hours. I want to talk to you again, okay?
That would be great. And thank you for all you do with this channel.
Thank you, Jake. We'll definitely talk again. Lord bless you.
Bye-bye.
All right.
I don't see ya. Good afternoon, good evening.
Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
I'll be back.